guys, so let's start off with what this video is going to be about. This video is going to try and answer some of the questions that we've been getting about building a motor, the components we used, why we chose them, horsepower goals, how we're putting it in the car, etc., etc., etc. I want to thank everybody who's been watching the series, commenting, questions, you know, everything that's been going on. This is why we're going to do this video. So let's start with how the car came. The car was a 289 automatic car. Made like 190 horsepower, couldn't even do a burnout. So that wasn't gonna last for someone like me. I wanted 500 horsepower and a manual transmission. So 500 horsepower in a 302 isn't really that great of an idea. Check out some of the links here for a why. So for us, we know that running a 351 Windsor is pretty easy choice. It fits the same cylinder heads as a 302. It fits the same motor mounts as a 302. Bell housing fits. The thing is, it's a little bit taller, so it's a little bit wider. The intakes don't work, but we know that this motor physically fits in the car under a stock hood, which is one of the main things I want to keep. So 351 Windsor is the way we did it. So 500 horsepower on a 351, pretty easy to do. Cylinder heads, intake, camshaft, carburetor. That was our first setup. We put all that together, dropped it in the car. It was great. The car was really fun. It lasted about 6 or 8 months, and then it got boring. Again, the power's not there. I wanted more, like any other car guy. So that led us to this. Let's add a supercharger. So to put a supercharger on a car, what do you have to do? Let's get to all those questions. We're going to start off with saying, if you're going to be building a 351 Windsor, why don't you check out our first video that goes through all the things that we did to set it up. That link's right here. If you want to start putting that motor in the car, you can see how we did ours. Some of the things that we ran into and how we overcame those, that link will be right here. For us, we started at the bottom, oil pan. We chose a Mylodon pan, extra capacity, because we put a high volume oil pump in. For the expensive parts we're going to be putting in, I'd rather more volume of oil going to lubricate those, so hopefully we don't burn them down. On top of that stuff, we went with a stroker kit. Why? Because we're going to be replacing the crank, the connecting rods, and the pistons. Yeah, I can go and put the stock stuff in, but why not make it a stroker, increase that displacement, which is one of the easiest ways to get horsepower, and again, it's all going to be the strong stuff because we're going to be buying it all new. Back in the old days, you would have to source all of these components from different manufacturers to do all the math. Luckily, 2019, I can just make one phone call, Eagle Specialty Products, and they have stroker kits sitting on the shelf that they can send right out to your door. For us, we went with a fully forged kit. That means a forged connecting rod, forged pistons, and H-beam rods. On top of that kit, we added ARP 2000 bolts. Those are better bolts into the connecting rod, so hopefully we can make just a bit more horsepower and not have to worry. To put that kit into our engine block, we had to do some stuff. We had it bored 30 over. We had the bottom of the cylinder bores clearanced out. Since now the crankshaft has a larger swing, it'll hit the bottom of the bores if you don't clearance them. This is all stuff that's pretty common and an engine building shop can help you out with. So we had them take our block. Like I said, they put new cam bearings in. They clearanced the bottom for the stroker kit. They flat decked it. They went through the whole thing and made sure that it was good to go and reliable for the powers that we wanted to hit. On top of that block, we put a set of cylinder heads, obviously. The best part about building an engine is a cylinder head. You really want to spend all of the money that you can in cylinder heads. Cheap out on some other things here and there, but really, anytime you want to build power, put the most expensive cylinder head that you can afford on it. Even if it means a couple extra months of saving to get that power where you need it. We went with a set of Dart Pro 1s. They're a CNC ported head. We added a little bit of home porting to them. Nothing crazy, but just trying to smooth some of the flows out so we can get air in and out of that motor. With these cylinder heads, we wanted to make sure we were going to do a roller rocker conversion. We went to Scorpion and got a set of 1.6 ratio Scorpion roller rockers. They do make a 1.7, which will make your cam seem a little bit bigger, but I don't need any of that stuff. Let's just keep it the factory 1.6 ratio. Underneath that, we did a nice set of push rods that dropped down to our Ursin roller lifters. We had to do a conversion lifter in our block as it was not a hydraulic roller block, but we're using a hydraulic roller camshaft. So we went to our friends over at Ursin and got some of theirs. Conversion lifters, like we're talking about, are very expensive. They're two, maybe three times as expensive as a flat tappet lifter, but they free up a lot of extra horsepower. The cams can be a lot more aggressive, the duration can be a little bit longer, and because of that, you're gonna make more power. So you have to match those to the cam. We went to Comp Cams and got an XE274 hydraulic roller camshaft. We know that for our power band and where we want that power to come in, we're not gonna be right off idle. So we chose a cam where the power comes in a little bit later and holds on a little longer. That's how we got to our cam. So the cam and the lifters match. We've now talked about everything from the heads down, what's left on a motor, intake. So for us, again, we went over to Edelbrock. We chose an Edelbrock Victor Jr. It's a single plane intake, which means there's no divider in the middle, and it's a little bit shorter than the Victor Senior. We're trying to keep all under a stock hood, so we wanted to try and get a small intake, but I really wanted a single plane to match the power band. I even took the intake over to a machine and I took 5/8 of an inch off the top of it. Again, I'm trying to stay under that stock hood. So now we've talked about everything other than an induction system and boost. So on top of this, you can put whatever you want, a carburetor or an EFI system. For us, for ease of tuning and drivability, we went with an EFI. We called Holly and got one of their Sniper 1250 kits. It looks like a carburetor, but it's a full functioning EFI fuel injection setup. You can tune it with a laptop, it'll tune itself, and it's one of those real cool things you just bolt on, answer a couple quick questions, and boom, you start it up and drive. So we chose their 1250. This kit will work on a motor from 400 to 1200 horsepower, which means it's great for you guys like me who started off with a 500 horsepower car and now we're trying to get this way, way, way crazy 1000 horsepower mark that everybody wants. So you can start off here and add boost next year, add more boost the year after, and so on and so on and so on, and grow into this kit. You only have to buy it once. Kind of makes sense. We also wanted to keep this hood clearance like I keep talking about. So to put a supercharger on, we went with a centrifugal unit. That hangs off the side of the motor, real nice and low. It's not like those Roots ones that sit on top and you know you have to cut the hood and everything else. This one sits off to the side, it's nice and low, and we get the same benefits. So we went with a Novi 2000, that's made by Paxton. It's an older unit, but they make a ton of power and they're readily available for everything from a Mustang all the way up to a Viper you can buy the same blower for. So that's kind of, in a nutshell, how we got to our engine build. If I missed anything or you guys have any other questions, we are attaching a PDF in the description below, and that's gonna go through all the part numbers, you know, a brief description of the parts that we used and everything. So hopefully that'll answer some more of your questions, or if you're trying to make the engine the exact same as ours, here it is. Here's all the part numbers you need. I'm trying to make it a little bit easier for you. Now, horsepower goals. Like I said, I wanted to be around 500 horsepower when this car started. Naturally aspirated, this motor should be around 530, 540, somewhere in there. You might say, well, why'd you go through all that work for 30 or 40 horsepower? It's not that peak horsepower there that we're concerned with. It's the availability to grow into, you know, 8, 9, maybe 1,000 horsepower. So yeah, maybe some stock components would do it, but I want this thing to be reliable. I want to take it out on a Sunday or Saturday just because, and not have to worry, oh man, that's the fourth time I've used it. It's probably gonna blow up the next time. Spend a little bit of money, have something that's reliable. So guys, hopefully that'll go through and answer a bunch of questions. Like I said, if there's anything else that I've missed, make sure to drop it in the comment below. We'll go through, I answer every single question or comment that we get. So, you know, make sure you stay tuned. We're getting real close to firing this thing up. I did some fuel stuff yesterday. We're gonna be dropping the tank in tomorrow. So hopefully we can get back and show you what this thing sounds like, get it out on the road and make some power. How's it going? Today we're gonna do a comparison on the PRW versus the DSS main girdle for a 351 Windsor. We have our block fresh back from the machine shop, and the PRW girdle that we bought, it's a little bit of a cheaper brand, but you can see we had the clearance here, here, all up here for the oil pump, this surface, and this back surface here to clear the counterweights on the crank. We didn't even get to spin the crank yet to see if it fit in these areas. And when we torqued down the nuts for the girdle on the mains, it stripped the nut off. So that led to us throwing this pile of garbage into the garbage. And we bought the billet DSS main support system. This one doesn't need any clearancing front and back for the oil pan. It's clearanced perfectly for the oil pump. And if you flip it over, it's got really nice machining in it to clear all the counterweights on the crank. So let's put it on and see what we get.